Multiculturalism flourishes when cultural values are accepted. What is multiculturalism? And what is the international version of it? These are among the hottest debates in our societies these days. Does multiculturalism mean to blend all cultures in one pot or to keep all ethnic communities separated from each other? For instance, in my own country, Canada, the Department of Canadian Heritage defines multiculturalism as such. Quote, multiculturalism ensures that all citizens can keep their identities, can take pride in their ancestry and have a sense of belonging, unquote. But belonging to what? To one's own ethnic community or to Canadian society? This definition states further, quote, the Canadian experience has shown that multiculturalism encourages racial and ethnic harmony and cross-cultural understanding and discourages ghettoization, hatred, discrimination, and violence, unquote. How does it discourage ghettoization? It is hard to explain this part while saying the multiculturalism also encourages the sense of belonging to one's own ethnicity. So these are delicate issues. The largest multicultural mosaic on the planet is India. Let's have a look at this great model. In today's world, many countries claim to be good multicultural societies, but India is a multicultural society for thousands of years. India is welcoming every religion and every culture for thousands of years. Unfortunately, some brutal invaders took the advantage of India's welcoming nature and inflicted their brutalities during the past centuries. India eventually fought them back with its very power of multiculturalism. According to the 1961 census of India, there are over 1600 indigenous languages in the country. The culture of India has been shaped by its long history, unique geography, and diverse demography. India's languages, religions, dance, music, architect, and customs differ from place to place within the country, but nevertheless possess a commonality. The culture of India is an amalgamation of these diverse subcultures spread all over the Indian subcontinent and traditions that are centuries old. Religiously, Hindus form the majority, followed by Muslims, Christians, Sikhs, Buddhists, Jains, Baha'is, Jews, Zoroastrians, and others. Linguistically, the two main language families in India are Indo-Aryan, a branch of Indo-European, and Dravidian. In India's northeast, people speaking Sino-Tibetan group of languages. India officially follows a three-language policy. Hindi, spoken in the form of Hindustani, is the official federal language. English has the federal status of associate official language, and each state has its own state official language. Further, India does not have any national language. The Republic of India's state boundaries are largely drawn based on linguistic groups. This decision led to the preservation and continuation of local ethno-linguistic subcultures. Thus, most states differ from one another in language, culture, cuisine, clothing, literary style, architecture, music, and festivities. The Indian Constitution requires the various state-run institutions to provide quotas for minorities, which give these cultural minorities equal opportunities as well as a forum through which they can actively participate in the institutions. Hence, India is the best example of multicultural society where people speak over 120 major languages and over 1600 other languages. Unity in diversity is the beauty of India, and the Indian Constitution assigns equal rights, privileges and duties to all people irrespective of gender, caste, class, community, language and religion. The Indian society has been multicultural, multi-religious, multi-racial, multi-ethnic and multilinguistic from time immemorial. At the same time, India has been confronted with forces of divisiveness. The biggest challenge before major cultural countries like India is to preserve the pluralistic tradition and to bring the various communities into the mainstream society by promoting the spirit of multiculturalism. Unlike multicultural nations such as Canada, Australia, USA, UK and European Union, where people of different cultures look very much alike in their physical size and facial features, dress, language, food habits, religious practices, way of life, people of India show clear distinctions in their physique, dress, language, food habits, religious practices and rituals. Threat to multiculturalism comes when a group starts thinking in a narrow way, considering themselves as superior to others and show discrimination and animosity to other groups. Considering the multiculturalism, the Indian Constitution has included innumerable acts by which the marginalized sections of the country are given sufficient protection and special privileges. The term multiculturalism has a range of meanings within the context of society, political philosophy, and colloquial use. In sociology and in everyday usage, it is a synonym for ethnic pluralism, with the two terms often used interchangeably, and for cultural pluralism, in which various ethnic groups collaborate and enter into a dialogue with one another without having to sacrifice their particular identities. It can describe a mixed ethnic community area where multiple cultural traditions exist. In reference to sociology, multiculturalism is the end state of either a natural or artificial process and occurs on either a large national scale or on a smaller scale within a nation's communities. On a smaller scale, this can occur artificially when a jurisdiction is established or expanded by amalgamating areas with two or more different cultures. Examples are French Canada and English Canada. In reference to political science, multiculturalism can be defined as a state's capacity to effectively and efficiently deal with cultural plurality within its sovereign borders. Multiculturalism as a political philosophy involves ideologies and policies which vary widely. It has been described as a salad bowl in terms of cultural mosaic in contrast to a melting pot. Multiculturalism is seen by its supporters as a fairer system that allows people to truly express who they are within a society that is more tolerant and that adapts better to social issues. They argue that culture is not one definable thing based on one race or religion, but rather the result of multiple factors that change as the world changes. In context of those philosophies, I shall go back to my own Canadian model of multiculturalism. I remember seeing hundreds of thousands of people were celebrating Caribana in Toronto. One could go see faces from all of Canada's diverse communities having fun while celebrating Caribbean culture and music. Along with those of Caribbean origin, thousands and thousands of other Canadians and visitors enjoyed spicy food and a hot parade. Every participant was getting familiarized with the Caribbean culture. That was so cool. That was the spirit our multicultural policymakers loved to see. But the question arises, is multiculturalism just a unilateral phenomenon? The outlines of our multicultural policy clearly suggest our newcomers sticking to their own culture. It barely suggests they get to know about Canada. Our politicians and policymakers encourage the immigrants to propagate only their own music, films, literature, back home news and politics. We never encourage ethnic media outlets to write or report something about Canadian literature, art, music and culture in general. How is an outsider to know Canada without reading stories of Alastair MacLeod, Margaret Atwood, Alice Munro, Barbara Gordy, and Michael Winter? How can a new immigrant know Canadian music without listening to the tragically hip Nickelback, Shania Twain, or Nelly Furtado? What does multiculturalism mean here? Does it mean to know and retain one's own culture only? Does that mean that white Canadians are compelled to learn about immigrants, food, music, and festivals? Multiculturalism in its true form is a blend of different cultures. But we have shaped this reality the other way around. Our policymakers and political leaders clearly suggest that immigrants create and maintain their own communities, what I see as ghettos. As a nation, we are proud of being the first country on earth to implement a formal multicultural policy. But the fact is that multiculturalism cannot flourish just through official policies. Its future depends upon the common sharing attitude of all. Yes, it is more related to the attitude than to the responsibility. Indeed, we cannot have a precise proportional recipe for it. It varies from situation to situation. As an immigrant or outsider, if you don't own your new chosen home, you never relate yourself to the new realities. True, it is not simple. It is a constant struggle. Most of us as immigrants were ready to integrate ourselves in Canada when we were leaving our back homes. But we forgot that goal when we landed here and saw governments were dying to help us retain our own culture as our way of life. Our ethnic ghettos serve political parties as concentrated vote banks, no matter we don't well serve society at large. That is why Canada's basic values, such as freedom of expression, gender equality, and openness, are being threatened by big ghettos created in the name of multiculturalism. Instead of blending cultures, we are rattling our basic values, which are the pride of this country. We are also discouraging those immigrants who are attracted to Canada by our fundamental human liberties. Multiculturalism flourishes only when cultural values are accepted and intermingled.